In this winter's tale, it's January that turns out to be the cruelest month. They leave Nebraska's frosted cornfields, always imposing, always highly ranked, but destined, it has seemed, for disappointment. He has these winters in his blood, the native son who never left, who in another time was twice the state's athlete of the year, a marvel who competed for his small hometown college. Tom Osborne, 22 seasons, 218 victories, 11 conference titles, but still bearing with serene dignity the January memories. Memories of hot, humid nights in Miami, when it was all or nothing in a stadium a long, long way from home. In 1984, there was honor in defeat. 10 years later, redemption was just one play away.
45 yards to give Cinderella, Nebraska the national championship. And he hooked and left. Florida State wins.
And though decades of success have been somehow diminished by a series of New Year's failings, the resolve remains. And now, even beyond the heartland, you sense he is, for most, the sentimental choice.
I don't think there's any room for compassion. I mean, we're playing a football game, and if he wasn't playing us for the national championship, I'd root for him.
To Tom Osborne, this is a familiar face of January, the face of another fierce Miami team, at home in the Orange Bowl, and prepared to deny the Cornhuskers a national title. Or is this finally the night when Nebraska's proud native son brings to an end his long New Year's nightmare?
Sellout of 78,000 for this 61st Orange Bowl game. And although the Nebraska Cornhuskers may have one of their finest teams ever, and though you'll see plenty of Nebraska supporters clad in red tonight, this is still their formidable task. To win here, in this Miami sound machine, where the Hurricanes have lost only once since 1985, and but for a single bad quarter against Washington back in September, the Hurricanes would themselves be undefeated and poised to win their fifth national title in 12 seasons. As it is, Miami does have a slim chance to win the title, but the Canes must beat the Cornhuskers tonight and hope that somehow number 2 Penn State loses to Oregon in tomorrow's Rose Bowl. Only Nebraska can get by without any help. If they win tonight, they're the champs, no matter what happens anywhere else. Everybody, I'm Bob Costas. Happy New Year to you. These are the trophies signifying an Orange Bowl victory and the national title, both at stake tonight. Nebraska is seeking its first national title since the Johnny Rogers team of 1971, and the first in Tom Osborne's 22-year tenure, an otherwise magnificent tenure diminished by New Year's day and night setbacks. Osborne's teams have now lost 7 straight bowl games, including the last 3 Orange Bowls, and tonight the opponent is Miami at home. Miami, 3-0 against Nebraska in the Orange Bowl. To get it done, Nebraska's Osborne has reinstalled Tommy Frazier as his starting quarterback. The option specialist began the year as a Heisman candidate, but he hasn't played since September 24th, stricken with blood clots in his right leg. The decision to start Frazier over Brooke Behringer, who played well in Frazier's absence, has already been second-guessed. But Tom Osborne has long since become accustomed to the scrutiny and criticism that comes with the territory. 22 seasons of excellence, icon status in his home state,
yet he has never made himself larger than his team. Guarded, stoic, we probably know Tom Osborne best, not from his words, but from a moment, a defining moment, the 1984 Orange Bowl.
Look at this play, Jeff Smith. Touchdown, Nebraska!
Choosing victory over a tie, attempting a two-point conversion. His boldness cost him the national title. And now, perhaps another defining moment, this week choosing Tommy Frazier as his starting quarterback.
Find any irony in the fact that it's easy to label you as conservative, but you're the guy who went for two when a tie assured you of the national championship. You're the guy who's rolling the dice now with Frazier.
Well, I don't know, Bob. I don't really think in terms of image and those kind of things. I just think in terms of what I feel needs to be done. And nobody wants to focus on who's playing tackle or who's playing safety. And those spots are every bit as critical as quarterback. I'm very comfortable with our quarterbacks. They're going to play okay. I'm a little bit more worried about some other spots.
You know what the long-standing observations or criticisms are. Schedule's not tough enough outside of Oklahoma and in recent years Colorado. Philosophy's too conservative. Run the ball between the tackles, win the Big Eight title, run up against competition you can't handle on New Year's Day. Has any of that been fair?
Oh, I'm sure whatever's fair, whatever people say, I don't care what they say. And all I know is that we've got a certain climate to play in. We have a certain schedule that's usually set 6, 7, 8 years in advance. And we think that in our climactic situation, you've got to be prepared to handle two or three bad weather days. On the other hand, maybe Miami, if they had to play January 1st in Lincoln or in Omaha, might find that their style wouldn't fit quite as well either.
Here's a quote from a week or so ago in the New York Times. No one ever predicts a derailing loss, but many wonder if it is their destiny. You're a practical man, but have you ever wondered if that's your destiny?
Well, I really never thought that way. We lost Oklahoma the first five or six times that I think that I was a head coach and played him. But I didn't feel like we were always going to lose to Oklahoma. We just tried to work harder and get better. And we lost pretty badly to Florida State a couple times and Miami a couple times. And we worked hard and we got better. And I think last year we played well enough to win.
I asked Bobby Bowden this a year ago, and he tried to put it in perspective. He said the world wouldn't end. But when I asked him, would your resume be incomplete if you never got a national championship? He said yes. How about you?
Well, I don't think so. I think in the eyes of a lot of people, that would be the case. But I really don't tend to measure success or whatever I've accomplished or haven't accomplished in football so much in wins and losses. I think when you die, they always say, well, he won so many, he lost so many, he won so many national championships, or he didn't. And yet, I think that's kind of a hollow way to look at it.
Do you feel a kinship at all with guys like Marv Levy, Bud Grant? Great coaches. Grant's in the Hall of Fame. Levy's probably going there. Did everything but win the Super Bowl. Mm-hmm. Similar position to, at least at this moment, where you are.
Well, I don't know if I feel a kinship, Bob, but I never cease to be amazed at the mentality that, you know, the Minnesota Vikings were losers or that the Buffalo Bills are losers. It's kind of an interesting commentary on our society. It's kind of like, if you're not number one, you're nothing. I mean, to win 12 games, to go through what our players have gone through this year, I admire them greatly. I don't necessarily admire them as a coach. I admire what the players have done in terms of their commitment, their devotion, and their determination to get back down here and to try it again.
In our interview, Osborne also said he supported some form of college football playoff. The present bowl coalition and upcoming bowl alliance have improved the chances of crowning a true national champ, but they are at best imperfect. This year's top teams being a perfect example, as both Nebraska and Penn State could wind up undefeated and yet never meet on the field, said Osborne. We've gotten so conscious of payoffs and money, we've almost sold our souls. There should be some way to get it done. Coming up, a tale of three quarterbacks. Nebraska's Tommy Frazier is one. He's back as the starter tonight. And then there's backup Brooke Boehringer, 7-0 in relief. And the forgotten man in all of this, Miami's Frank Costa. We'll return to the Orange Bowl after this.
National championship for Nebraska.
That
was how Miami won its first national title, the fingertips of Kenny Calhoun preventing Nebraska's two-point conversion. The 1988 Orange Bowl had future NFL notable Steve Walsh connecting with Michael Irvin and Jimmy Johnson taking a national title from Oklahoma's Barry Switzer. In 92, behind Heisman Trophy winner Gino Toretta, Miami won its fourth national title in 9 years, its second for Dennis Erickson, with a shutout victory over Nebraska. It should be noted now that Miami's reputation for invincibility here was momentarily rocked earlier this season. A home winning streak that had reached an NCAA record 58 games was halted in September by the Washington Huskies. Tonight, Miami faces a much better team, a Nebraska team with increased speed and aggressiveness on defense, and a team that lost its starting quarterback early and won anyway. Now Tommy Frazier is back in charge with his proven replacement, Brooke Behringer, available for quick relief.
People said that having two quarterbacks in there going in and out, it might hurt the offensive scheme. But I don't think, in our case, it will, because we both do something different.
We may have different strengths as far as running and throwing football, but I think we're both capable of running the entire Nebraska offense, and that's all you can ask out of each of us.
The question here isn't competence. It's Osborne's intuition. It was Behringer who guided the Cornhuskers back to the big show. So why entrust the team to a player who hasn't taken a snap in a game since September 24th?
Tommy hadn't played in about 9 games, I think. I think he's ready to take on offense like that, is he? After missing 9 games, the option is all timing. So if he's gotten his timing back in the last 2 weeks, then put him in there.
Tommy's been practicing for 2 months. He's just been on blood thinners, so he couldn't have major contact. But as far as being full speed, running, and executing our offense, he's been doing it all the time, so it isn't like he's rusty or he's stale.
Also, Frazier has been here before. At last year's Orange Bowl, he excelled, 283 yards of total offense against Florida State, as Nebraska came within 2 points of the national title. This year began with legitimate Heisman aspirations for Frazier, but then he was suddenly sidelined by blood clots in his right leg. Still, he stayed in shape, hoping.
All the hard work that I put in, it paid off knowing no way that I was just out there working hard for nothing. It's like you have a job and you go work for nothing. That's the way I felt.
I hate to get it this way, but it's been a great opportunity for me to get out and show what I can do and prove my coaches and teammates that I was a capable player.
Capable and gutsy. Behringer played part of this season with a collapsed lung. His reward is now unclear.
I'm not really sure how much difference it's going to make who comes in when or why. Hopefully that everybody will be mentally prepared enough to play that it's really not going to make a whole lot of difference who's in, where, and when.
I bring excitement, big play capability, something that I always bring to the offense since I've been started as a freshman.
We come in and play 4-3 defense with our covers behind us, and we're going to line up and play ball. It doesn't matter who they stick back there. It doesn't matter to us.
All right, joining us now, our game analyst, Chris Collinsworth. He'll have the call along with Tom Hammond. Agree or disagree with Tom Osborne's decision?
Absolutely agree 100%. You know, Tommy Frazier reminds me of you a little bit. Neither one of you worked that much during football season, but now for the national championship game, it's time for the stars to come out.
You know, an excellent analogy, and on that basis, I am sure the young man will excel.
Thank you very much. But you have to go back to what happened last year in this Orange Bowl game. Play for play against Charlie Ward, Tommy Frazier was there, was making the plays, and I think he's going to do the same things tonight.
All right, let's get the thoughts of our sideline reporter, John Dockery, who's down there watching the clubs warm up. Doc?
Thank you, Bob. I talked to Tommy Frazier a little while ago, and he said he's absolutely relaxed, focused, feeling no after effects from the blood clot problem. I also talked to the quarterback coach, Turner Gill, from Nebraska, and he said, hey, Frazier will start. He's 100%. He's fine. No problem, but that we would definitely see Brooke Behringer in the first half, probably in the first quarter. That's it from the field, Bob. Back to you.
Thanks, John. Well, it is an unusual situation when you have a Miami game and the focus is not on the Miami quarterback. After all, 5 of the school's recent alumni at the position are now playing in the NFL. Frank Costa is the current starter. He's had a stormy career with the Hurricanes, in part because he's been battered by unreasonable expectations.
this year I can care less what a fan will say. I can care less what a newspaper reporter says. I can care less what a radio person says. I really don't care. And they could say whatever they want about me. As long as we win football games, that's all that matters.
At Miami, winning and winning big is expected. Last season, after a loss to rival Florida State in Game 5, a large measure of the blame was dumped on the team's junior quarterback. He was ripped on the radio and by Miami's vocal football alumni. Frank Costa wound up being benched, and sophomore Ryan Collins replaced him for the remainder of an unspectacular year. The anger of 1993 is still evident.
But I wasn't real happy with my situation, and you know, that wasn't very happy with what happened to me. So, you know, really, there were some negative thoughts toward Coach Erickson, the coaching staff, and the players, and the city of Miami, really, because it seemed like everything was just coming down on me.
Such is the price of failure, real or perceived, and the level of expectation at Miami, where notable predecessors include Jim Kelly and Bernie Kosar, who took the Canes to their first national title, and Vinny Testaverde, the 1986 Heisman Trophy winner.
It would be nice to be mentioned in the same breath with those guys because they're great players, but you know, I know all those guys, and they're human beings just like me, and you know, I can't control something. That's something that the public's going to do, and they're going to group me however they want to group me. And if you do win a national championship, people are going to respect you. If you don't, then they're going to, you know, bash you apart and rip you apart. You know, this game's going to, you know, tell a lot of where I stand in the history of Miami quarterbacks.
Although he may not measure up to some of his predecessors at Miami, Costa is still a better passer than either Nebraska's Frazier or Beringer, and he could very well deliver a big game tonight. Now, late yesterday, Tom Osborne injected another element into the Nebraska quarterback debate. Call it the elephant equation. Five elephants appearing in tonight's halftime show. There are the plodding and pungent pachyderms. Well, they tore up parts of the field in rehearsal on Friday. Osborne, somewhat miffed, said if the elephant tracks were too deep, he might have to play the taller Beringer over Frazier. Of course, if the big fellas leave a calling card or two, then Frazier's agility might prove useful. Back after this.